Hey everyone, it's Sean. If this is your first time checking out my YouTube channel, my name is Sean Barry and I'm a creative professional with over 30 years experience in the business. I'm also partner and creative director of a small boutique agency here in Toronto, Ontario, Canada called Booster Rocket Media, where we do all kinds of cool things like graphic design, video editing, animation, and much more. And welcome to episode number 5 of the Design 101 series, and today's subject is alignment. Now, when I say alignment, what I'm talking about is the alignment of objects, one to another, and within a design space. This is, you've probably heard the term grid design. You've likely heard designers talk about grids. I talk about grids often. If you've watched any of my other videos, it's come up. So you may know the term, you may have seen examples of it. But this is the basic, I would say, first step to understanding grids. So if you've never used them before and that term is still a bit ambiguous to you, understand that this is the basic introduction to the grid idea. And what a grid provides you with is a means of alignment. That's really what it is. All the fancy terminology and philosophical statements about it in design terms are kind of meaningless. It essentially means, where does something line up so that something else on the page lines up with it in some way, which is logical and easy for you to follow. So alignment is the first step in understanding that. Now, when we talk about alignment, what I really mean is that if you have two objects on the page, where are they? Are they aligned to the left, to the right? Are they at the edge of the page, inside the page? There's some basic sort of ideas behind that, and I want to share those ideas with you to plant the seed so you can start thinking about alignment, because graphic design, really polishing your work, isn't necessarily about your big ideas. What separates a pro designer from an amateur designer, more often than not, in fact, are the small things like file management. What kind of quality files do you build? What software do you use? How proficient are you at it? And things like alignment and basic design execution. Those things are really important as a pro. Your big ideas develop over a long period of time. That's a skill you evolve as you evolve as a designer. But you can start on day one getting things aligned properly. And if you build those habits now, then your design work will be much stronger in the future. So let's dive into it. I'm going to show you examples of what I mean by basic alignment. And I'll show you a few examples from my portfolio as well that will help express the idea in action. Although it's not going to be anything very complicated, but I think you'll get it once I show you kind of how these things work. So let's just dive into it. You'll see what I mean right away. Okay, so here back at the desktop, I've got my little InDesign file here. This is just an arbitrary file. It's a 12-inch by 12-inch canvas, which doesn't mean anything. You shouldn't pay attention to that or even the size of this block, but it's basically there's a block inside of a white space, and that's all you really need to know about this. Now, this canvas may be an arbitrary size, and this square is an arbitrary size, but we're going to sort of talk about ways that these things relate to each other. Right now, the only relationship between these two objects is the fact that this square is indeed in this canvas, kind of sitting there right there. That's what it is. And now we're going to talk about various alignments, which are, again, the predecessor to grid design, and I think you'll see how this kind of works as we go. Now, if I come down to my next page, I have moved the square. So now this square, if I click on this, and I go up to my reference point here in my top left of my InDesign panel, it shows me where this is on the page. Now, the center of this block is at 6 inches by 6 inches, which on a 12-inch by 12-inch canvas is dead center, which is the most basic alignment of any kind. Every word processing package, any basic communication or visual building tool of any sort can align things to the center. Centering something is kind of the rudimentary first way that you ever figure out how to align anything. So this is aligned to the center of the canvas. That is the beginnings of alignment. Now, another kind of alignment, I just made this term up right now on the spot, but we'll call this complete alignment. Now, what this is here's a big black box. I didn't change my canvas in any way. The canvas is still right where it always has been. But now this black box is the same size as the canvas. Now, that's not the whole story, though. You could look at this and go, oh, it's a black background on the canvas. But, okay, yes, it is, but it's something else, too. It is a square, which is exactly the same size, shape, and position as the canvas. And that means certain things for alignment. It is still aligned in the center if I look at my reference point. It's still in the middle. That hasn't changed. Its dimensions have changed. But that's not all there is to it either. The dimensions are now exactly the same as the canvas. And because of that, in addition to being center aligned, it is also left, top, right, and bottom aligned to the canvas. In other words, it shares all the canvas's properties except that it's a black shape and it's a white canvas. But you get the idea that this is aligned in every way possible. So that's another way to think about alignment, but let's look at the more practical ways. So going back to our one square example, I've moved the square. So now the square is up in the top left corner, but it's not exactly actually in the top left corner. It's simply up towards the top left corner. This would in fact be arguably the top left corner, but that's not where my box is. However, if I click on this and I look at my reference point and I click in the top left so I get my reference from the top left, you can see that it's half an inch in on the x-axis, half an inch down on the y-axis, which means there's a half an inch between this box and the edge of the canvas on the top and left side. That's a mathematical alignment. I'm picking a certain point and saying, this is where I want it to be, but it's based on an idea. It's not sitting here, so it's a half an inch on the left, but 0.72 on the top. I don't want that. I want it to be exactly half an inch and half an inch. And the reason I do that is because I might want to add another shape to this. So now I want to deliver on that idea of alignment even further. So now this box has changed size slightly, and there's two of them. So the box is now 5 1/4 inches square. And it's still, if I look at my reference point, a half an inch in from the left. However, it's also half an inch from the other block, which is half an inch from the right side of the canvas. And if I select both of these together, so that they become effectively one object as far as InDesign is concerned, if I click on my center reference point, I am at 6 inches by 6 inches, which is dead center of a 12 inch by 12 inch canvas. So there's top alignment, there's bottom alignment, there are gutters and margins now, all of which are half an inch on the horizontal. So that is now several different types of alignment, as well as being in the center of the canvas. Now this top and bottom space seem arbitrary, but they're not really. They're exactly mathematically what's left from having two boxes in exactly this position on the top and bottom. Those spaces are equal, but somewhat arbitrary. However, if we move these boxes towards the top now, we can introduce our half an inch margin at the top. So now we have half an inch on three sides of the canvas and a half an inch gutter between the two objects, which are the same size and are still lined up horizontally. And they are on the horizontal center, even though it's not the complete center of the canvas. So we still have a bunch of different types of alignment going on here, all based on the same basic ideas. And if I introduce two more of these blocks, well, now you can see that I've expanded all this. I've added now a half an inch all the way around on every side, and I've got a half an inch gutter running between all the shapes. I've got the two left blocks are left aligned, the two right blocks are right aligned, the two top blocks are horizontally aligned, as are the two bottom blocks. And these two blocks are aligned diagonally, as well as these two blocks are aligned diagonally. So I got a bunch of different alignments going on in this very simple composition, which looks like it has nothing in particular going on at all. So again, this is alignment, not grid design, but it's the foundation for thinking that way and understanding how grids work. If I remove the two blocks on the top and replace them with just one, I've maintained all of my alignments with three objects instead of four. So that's an interesting little mathematical change, but all the other alignment is basically the same. As you can see, the left side, the right side, the bottom, the top, and the canvas, all the alignments are still working in the same way, but we've just got a different configuration now. However, I threw this in to kind of make a point and to at least discuss this as an idea. I've changed some of the math. Now, what I've done is I've left these three blocks. I've added, obviously, one more block to the bottom row. And so now I've got four blocks again, although the configuration of those four is different. One on the top, three on the bottom. But they no longer follow the alignment. So you might say, well, listen, everything's on the page. It is in the right order. It has the proper hierarchy. Who cares if there's exactly a 5 inch between them why would I go through all the trouble of figuring that out? Well, I would lose in an argument if I tried to tell you, oh no, this is not the right layout. You shouldn't do this. Of course you can. You can do anything that you want. And this looks perfectly fine in the sense that everything is on the page that needs to be there. However, if I jump down to my next page where I've observed the same idea of alignment, you can see that it's just more polished. It's more together, even though everything on the page here is also here. I've changed no content whatsoever. I've only changed my alignment strategy so that now things are aligned. Everything has a consistent border. I recalculated the size of these bottom three so that I could still leave exactly half an inch between all three of them and on the sides, and that took a little bit of math. Basically, these shapes became 3.33 inches wide instead of 5 1/4 inches wide. But you get the idea that with a little bit of math and thinking, I was able to maintain this basic grid, even though it's not a grid yet, it's just alignment, but you get the idea. Now, going one more further, this checkerboard pattern doesn't mean anything. And the only reason I'm really showing you this checker pattern is not to make a design point, but just to say that as complex an arrangement of elements as I can think of in alignment, as long as I follow a basic idea or a basic strategy, I can line things up in various ways. There are a bunch of black squares which are horizontally aligned, vertically aligned, and diagonally aligned. And they, using negative space, create an equal amount of white squares which are also horizontally aligned, vertically aligned, and diagonally aligned. So there's all these different alignments you can think of by observing this checker pattern. There's no point in making a checker pattern, but just understand that you can look at it those different ways. And that's the idea of alignment, is to open your mind to these opportunities and find them in your design work. Now, over here in Photoshop, I just wanted to show you a few examples of things that I've worked on recently where I can talk a bit about alignment in practice, so you can actually see what I'm talking about when I say there's different ways to align things and different ways to think of alignment. In this case, this was a rough design. It isn't the final design, but it's a CD jacket for a new release by the local band Rock Attack. And so this was done as a test design. It isn't the final design. But basically the bottom right side here is the front cover. And I want to just focus on that quickly. Looking at this, there's a kind of alignment going on here that we haven't discussed yet. The blocks only give us limited ways of thinking of alignment. Here's another way, which is an interesting way, I think. So what we did was we took these two photographs. We did all the photography custom for this job, which was fun. My business partner and friend Anthony Taylor shot these. We've got these images on the front cover, but the images seem to be not exactly normal. And so when you look at Rock Attack's Small Pieces, which is the name of the album, we decided to take that concept all the way. So there's alignment going on here, which is not mathematical, but it's conceptual. So what we did was to cut up the different photos that we took, and we took Anita here on the left, but we put Oriana's eye and half of Oriana's bottom lip and a bit of Oriana's chin, etc., etc., and we did the same with the right side portrait. So we intermixed each of their portraits into these new obscure portraits, which are a combination of the two of them. And so alignment comes into play. The eyes are on the same line, the nose is on the same line, the chins are on the same line, the mouths are on the same line, etc., etc. So this is a conceptual kind of alignment. We just had an idea that we delivered by patching a bunch of things together and lining them up so that they appear to be a normal portrait, but on closer inspection there's something unusual, which was the whole idea. In this case, you can see this is actually the final design. Now we have all the dye line marks on it and everything that went to production. But I quickly want to talk about the different cover here. If I swing back down to my bottom right, this is the front cover we ended up going with in the final. And this is actually a collection of four different tapestries that we did some photography of. And I've just cut all the pieces and reassembled them into a mishmash. So there's alignment happening in this texture and pattern out here, but it's a chaotic kind of alignment. There's nothing in particular happening, except when you get into the middle. So now, much like our early box example, I have this red rectangle which is sitting dead center inside of this cover image. And inside of this dead center rectangle is dead center typography, which is right aligned and left aligned to itself, and then sitting in the center of the block, which is sitting in the center of the cover. So again, center alignment and then some conceptual alignment combined for this whole kind of new thing. Another quick example is this dance poster. Starting from the top and just going through this quickly, there is a sponsorship logo at the top, which is centered, along with the centered headline here, which is Upashana, the spirit of dance, presents Utkalika, Songs of Desire. This image leads you all the way down and kind of does this movement, and the smoke picks up and brings you down to this type down here, which is the type on the left side is left justified with the edge. We've got these red lines that are equal width as the image as well. And we got some type on the right side, and then logos on the bottom, all sort of center aligned. And so that's how we work with different kinds of alignment in a simple layout like this. And you can see that there's just a certain organization to it, and it makes sense to your eye when you see it. I could have done it more randomly, but I did it this way, kind of for that purpose. Now, if I pop over to the banner here, this is a different shape and configuration altogether, but it has some interesting aspects to it. This alignment is kind of a, I guess I could call this an alignment of motion, which is, again, just something I made up on the spot here to describe this idea, but it wasn't by accident that I did this. It's intentional. You see this red shape comes down, it flows into the arms, and the arms flow into this important type, which is the Upashana spirit of dance presents Utkalika, Songs of Desire. Now, as the image sort of brings you back and the smoke sort of takes you out to the edge, then you catch this type out here, Saturday, November 26th. This is an upcoming show at the time of this recording, but anyway, right justified type versus centered type on the left side. So you can see there's, again, different kinds of alignment, but they're not accidental and they're not random, they're kind of specific. The last example I want to show you is this Holland Holmes logo. We did this for our client last year. And if I turn on the guidelines, you can see that I've got some alignment over here on the H side on the left. So the H of Holland and the H of Holmes left align, and they're all contained, of course, inside this box, which has margins and all those things, as we talked about early on. But on the right side, the alignment's a little bit different. And this is the final kind of alignment I want to talk about. This is optical alignment. So if I drag this guide all the way out to the right side, hopefully your screen can see that, the furthest edge of this D on Holland is all the way out to this guideline, but the S on Holmes is not quite there. It's almost there, but not quite. You could accuse me of making an error, but you would be wrong. This is not an error, this is a choice. And this choice is called optical alignment. So if I look at these and I go, wait a second, they're not exactly aligned, what's going on? If I turn off the guides, however, and you look at it with your eyes, it looks aligned. And that is what optical alignment is. When you're dealing with unusual shapes, be them curves, often curves, combined with diagonal lines of some kind and shapes of different sizes and different configurations, sometimes you just have to look at them and go, okay, I got to nudge this one in, and I got to nudge that one out. Otherwise, they look like they don't quite line up. So it isn't perfectly mathematical, but optically it satisfies my eye, and it satisfies the eye of the viewer to say, this is an alignment, this looks good. So this is optical alignment, the final kind of version of alignment I wanted to share with you. So essentially, this is all the foundation for grid design. And if you think about this, and you look at a more complex grid down the road, hopefully you'll remember this video and come back and go, oh yeah, this is kind of what he was talking about. You know, this whole alignment and mathematical sort of gutters and margins and things that line up certain ways. Grids are a more complex expression of this, but this is the basic way to look at it. And as you think about alignment, look for opportunities in your layouts to make things just line up in a logical way that makes sense to your eye, and your layouts will improve without even having better concepts. Your layouts will just improve by being more together, and that's going to really help your portfolio long term. So I hope that made sense. I hope those examples made sense. Sometimes, you know, squares are kind of difficult to equate to other content, but I actually learned to use squares as just a way to work things out early on in my career. I used to work with this other graphic designer early on, who's now also my good friend, Randy Pricing. He's one of the best designers I know. He's awesome. His approach to things is super methodical. And he used to use boxes when he was experimenting with different things, whether it was grids or web design or animation. He would use those boxes and cubes to kind of, you know, try some things out. He would move some things around for animation as a test. Then later he would substitute his actual creative in. And it's a kind of a good trick, and I use it now myself all the time. But going beyond the squares, hopefully you get the idea that the example of that just lets you know that essentially things, whether they are top, bottom, side, left, right, inside, outside, there's always a relationship that you can build. And there's also a mathematical process you can follow. Everything's half an inch apart. Everything is 1 inch apart. Everything is in the center. Everything is left aligned, etc., etc. You do that kind of stuff, and that helps to elevate your book and to really tighten up your design understanding, because these little things are what inform you on the big projects. So when now you've got ideas to generate, you don't have to worry about how those ideas will look later, because all these small disciplines you've kind of gotten into your toolbox early. So that's my objective for this video, is just to give you one more tool in the toolbox, and every Design 101 hopefully can do that. So there'll be more Design 101 coming. The series is going to keep going as long as I can think of things to to do in the 101. So if you want to know something, a basic idea that you don't quite understand, feel free to comment below, and of course I will try to incorporate that into a future episode of Design 101. My regular YouTube videos will keep coming as well. I'll be working on some in the coming weeks. I'm also working on some premium courses, and they're in the works already. So in the meantime, you stay classy, and I'll catch you later. Goodbye.